Dear friends in Christ, on this most holy night, when our Lord Jesus Christ passed from death to life, the Church invites her children throughout the world to come together in vigil and prayer. This is the Passover of the Lord, when we venerate him in the mystery of his death and resurrection, through the celebration of the Paschal mystery in word and sacrament, he renews our faith and hope and gives us a share of his victory over death and in his eternal life with our most gracious God. Let us pray. Almighty God, we share in the light of your glory through your Son, the light of the world. Sanctify this new fire and inflame us with this new hope. Purify our minds by this Easter celebration and bring us to the feast of eternal light. We ask this through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Christ yesterday and today, the beginning and the end, the Alpha, the Omega. By his holy and glorious wounds, may our Lord Christ guard us and keep us. Amen.
rise and sing now all around us, bright with a glorious splendor. For darkness has been vanquished by our eternal King. Rejoice and be glad now, Mother Church, and let your holy courts in radiant light resound with the praises of your people. All you who stand near this marvelous and holy flame, pray with me to God the Almighty for the grace to sing the worthy praise of this great light. Through Jesus Christ, his Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with him in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever. Give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and good, always and everywhere, with a whole heart and mind and voice to invisible, almighty, and eternal God, and your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. For he is the true Paschal Lamb, who at the feast of the Passover paid for us the debt of Adam's sin, and by his blood delivered your faithful people. This is the night when you brought our ancestors, the children of Israel, out of bondage in Egypt, and led them through the Red Sea on dry land. This is the night when all who believe in Christ and delivered from the gloom of skin are restored to grace and holiness of life. This is the night when Christ broke the bonds of death and hell and rose victorious from the grave. And beyond our knowing, O God, is your mercy and loving kindness to us, that to redeem a slave, you gave a son. How holy is this night, when we is put to flight and sin is washed away. It restores innocence to the fallen, and joy to those who mourn. It casts out pride and hatred, and brings peace and concord. How blessed is this night, when earth and heaven are joined, and we are reconciled to God. Holy God, accept our evening sacrifice, the offering of this candle in your shine continually to drive away all darkness. May Christ, the morning star who knows no setting, find it ever gives his light to all creation, and who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Let us hear the record of God's saving deeds in history, how God saved the people in ages past, and let us pray that our God will bring each of us to the fullness of redemption.
The first lesson in which we hear the story of creation. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless void, and darkness covered the face of the deep, while a wind from God swept over the face of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light." And there was light, and God saw that the light was good. And God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. And God said, "Let there be a dome in the midst of the waters, and let it separate the waters from the waters." So God made the dome and separated the waters that were under the dome from the waters that were above the dome. And it was so. God called the dome sky. And there was evening, and there was morning, the second day. And God said, "Let the waters under the sky be gathered together into one place, and let the dry land appear." And it was so. God called the dry land earth, and the waters that were gathered together he called seas. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, "Let the earth put forth vegetation, plants yielding seed, and fruit trees bearing fruit of every kind on earth that bear fruit with the seed in it." And it was so. the earth brought forth vegetation, plants yielding seed of every kind, and trees of every kind bearing fruit with a seed in it. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the third day. And God said, "Let there be lights in the dome of the sky to separate the day from the night, and let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and years, and let them be lights in the dome of the sky to give light upon the earth." And it was so. God made the two great lights, the greater light to rule the day, and the lesser light to rule the night, and the stars. God set them in the dome of the sky to give light upon the earth, to rule over the day and over the night, and to separate the light from the darkness. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the fourth day. And God said, "Let the waters bring forth swarms of living creatures, and let birds fly above the earth across the dome of the sky." So God created the great sea monsters and every living creature that moves of every kind, with which the waters swarm, and every winged bird of every kind. And God saw that it was good. God blessed them, saying, "Be fruitful and multiply, and fill the waters and the seas, and let birds multiply on the earth." And there was evening, and there was morning, the fifth day. And God said, "Let the earth bring forth living creatures of every kind, cattle and creeping things, and wild animals of the earth of every kind." And it was so. God made the wild animals of the earth of every kind, and the cattle of every kind, and everything that creeps upon the ground of every kind. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, "Let us make humankind in our image, according to our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the wild animals of the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps upon the earth." So God created humankind in his image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. God blessed them, and God said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply, and fill the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the air, and over every living thing that moves upon the earth." God said, "See, I have given you every plant yielding seed that is upon the face of all the earth, and every tree with seed in its fruit. You shall have them for food. And to every beast of the earth, and to every bird of the air, and to everything that creeps on the earth, everything that has the breath of life, I have given every green plant for food." And it was so. God saw everything that he had made, and indeed, it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day. Thus, the heavens and the earth were finished, and all their multitude. And on the seventh day, God finished the work he had done, and he rested on the seventh day from all the work he had done. So God blessed the seventh day and hallowed it, because on it God rested from all the work he had done in creation. These are the generations of heavens and the earth when they were created.
It's for Let us pray. O God, who wonderfully created and yet more wonderfully restored the dignity of human nature, grant that we may share the divine life of him who humbled himself to share our humanity, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen.
The second lesson in which we hear of Israel's deliverance at the Red Sea. As Pharaoh drew near, the Israelites looked back, and there were the Egyptians advancing on them. In great fear, the Israelites cried out to the Lord. They said to Moses, "Was it because there were no graves in Egypt that you have taken us away to die in the wilderness? What have you done to us, bringing us out of Egypt? Is this not the very thing we told you in Egypt? Let us alone and let us serve the Egyptians, for it would have been better for us to serve the Egyptians than to die in the wilderness." But Moses said to the people, "Do not be afraid. Stand firm and see the deliverance that the Lord will accomplish for you today. For the Egyptians whom you see today, you shall never see again. The Lord will fight for you, and you have only to keep still." Then the Lord said to Moses, "Why do you cry out to me? Tell the Israelites to go forward. But you lift up your staff and stretch out your hand over the sea and divide it, that the Israelites may go into the sea on dry ground. Then I will harden the hearts of the Egyptians so that they will go in after them. And so I will gain glory for myself over Pharaoh and all his army, his chariots and his chariot drivers. And the Egyptians shall know that I am the Lord when I have gained glory for myself over Pharaoh, his chariots, and his chariot drivers." The angel of God, who was going before the Israelite army, moved and went behind them. And the pillar of cloud moved from in front of them and took its place behind them. It came between the army of Egypt and the army of Israel. And so the cloud was there with the darkness, and it lit up the night. One did not come near the other all night. Then Moses stretched out his hand over the sea. The Lord drove the sea back by a strong east wind all night and turned the sea into dry land, and the waters were divided. The Israelites went into the sea on dry ground, the waters forming a wall for them on their right and on their left. The Egyptians pursued and went into the sea after them, all of Pharaoh's horses, chariots, and chariot drivers. At the morning watch, the Lord, in the pillar of fire and cloud, looked down upon the Egyptian army and threw the Egyptian army into panic. He clogged their chariot wheels so that they turned with difficulty. The Egyptians said, "Let us flee from the Israelites, for the Lord is fighting for them against Egypt." Then the Lord said to Moses, "Stretch out your hand over the sea so that the water may come back upon the Egyptians, upon their chariots and chariot drivers." So Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and at dawn the sea returned to its normal depth. As the Egyptians fled before it, the Lord tossed the Egyptians into the sea. The waters returned and covered the Egyptians and the chariot drivers, the entire army of Pharaoh that had followed them into the sea. Not one of them remained. But the Israelites walked on dry ground through the sea, the waters forming a wall for them on their right and on their left. Thus the Lord saved Israel that day from the Egyptians. And Israel saw the Egyptians dead on the seashore. Israel saw the great work that the Lord did against the Egyptians. So the people feared the Lord and believed in the Lord and in his servant Moses.
Thank you. Let us pray. O God, whose wonderful deeds of old shine forth even to our own day, you once delivered by the power of your mighty arm your chosen people from slavery under Pharaoh, to be a sign for us of the salvation of all nations by the water of baptism. Grant that all the peoples of the earth may be numbered among the offspring of Abraham and rejoice in the inheritance of Israel. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen.
The third lesson, in which we hear of a new heart and a new spirit. Thus says the Lord God, I will take you from the nations and gather you from all the countries and bring you into your own land. I will sprinkle clean water upon you, and you shall be clean from all your uncleanliness, and from all your idols I will cleanse you. A new heart I will give you, and a new spirit I will put within you. And I will remove from your body the heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh. I will put my spirit within you and make you follow my statutes and be careful to observe my ordinances. Then you shall live in the land that I gave to your ancestors, and you shall be my people, and I will be your God.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, who in the Paschal mystery established the new covenant of reconciliation, grant that all who are reborn into the fellowship of Christ's body may show forth in their lives what they profess by their faith. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
The fourth lesson, in which we hear the valley of dry bones. The hand of the Lord came upon me, and he brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord, and set me down in the middle of a valley. It was full of bones. He led me all around them. There were very many lying in the valley, and they were very dry. He said to me, "Mortal, can these bones live?" I answered, "O Lord God, you know." Then he said to me, "Prophesy to these bones and say to them, 'O dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus says the Lord God to these bones, I will cause breath to enter you, and you shall live. I will lay sinews on you, and will cause flesh to come upon you, and cover you with skin, and put breath in you, and you shall live, and you shall know that I am the Lord.' So I prophesied as I had been commanded, and as I prophesied, suddenly there was a noise, a rattling, and the bones came together, bone to its bone. I looked, and there were sinews on them, and flesh had come upon them, and skin had covered them, but there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, 'Prophesy to the breath, prophesy, mortal, and say to the breath, Thus says the Lord God, Come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe upon these slain, that they may live.' I prophesied as he commanded me, and the breath came into them, and they lived and stood on their feet, a vast multitude. Then he said to me, 'Mortal, these bones are the whole house of Israel. They say our bones are dried up and our hope is lost. We are cut off completely. Therefore prophesy and say to them, Thus says the Lord God, I am going to open your graves and bring you up from your graves, O my people, and I will bring you back to the land of Israel, and you shall know that I am the Lord when I open your graves and bring you up from your graves, O my people. I will put my spirit within you, and you shall live. And I will place you on your own soil. Then you shall know that I, the Lord, have spoken and will act, says the Lord."
Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty God, by the Passover, your Son, you have brought us out of sin into righteousness and out of death into life. Grant to those who are sealed by your Holy Spirit the will and the power to proclaim you to all the world. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
The fifth lesson in which we hear of the gathering of God's people. Sing aloud, O daughter Zion. Shout, O Israel. Rejoice and exult with all your heart, O daughter Jerusalem. The Lord has taken away the judgments against you. He has turned away your enemies. The King of Israel, the Lord, is in your midst. You shall fear disaster no more. On that day it shall be said to Jerusalem, do not fear, O Zion, do not let your hands grow weak. The Lord your God is in your midst, a warrior who gives victory. He will rejoice over you with gladness. He will renew you in his love. He will exult over you with loud singing as on a day of festival. I will remove disaster from you so that you will not bear reproach for it. I will deal with all your oppressors at that time. And I will save the lame and gather the outcast. And I will change their shame into praise and renown in all the earth. At that time, I will bring you home, at the time when I gather you, for I will make you renowned and praised among all the peoples of the earth when I restore your fortunes before your eyes, says the Lord.
Sing a new song to God, who has done marvelous things. Shout with joy to God, all you lands. Lift up your voice and sing. Sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things. Shout with joy to God, all you lands. Lift up your voice and sing. With your right hand and your holy arm, have you won for yourself the victory? You have made known your victory. Your righteousness have you openly shown in the sight of the nations. Sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things. Shout with joy to the Lord, all you lands. Lift up your voice and sing. You remember your mercy and faithfulness to the house of Israel. All the lands of the earth have seen the victory of our God. Sing to God with a harp and the voice of song. Sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things. Shout with joy to the Lord, all you lands. Lift up your voice and sing. With trumpets and the sound of the horn, shout with joy before God who reigns in majesty. Let the sea make a noise, and all that is in it, the lands and those who dwell therein. Sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things. Shout with joy to the Lord, all you lands. Lift up your voice and sing. Let the rivers clap their hands, and let the hills righteousness and the peoples with equity. Sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things. Shout with joy to the Lord, O you lands, lift up your voice and sing. Sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things. Shout with joy to the Lord, O you lands, lift up your voice and sing. Lift up your voice and sing.
Let us pray. O God of unchangeable power and eternal light, look favorably on your whole church, that wonderful and sacred mystery. By the effectual working of your providence, carry out in tranquility the plan of salvation. Let the whole world see and know that things which were cast down are being raised up, and things which had grown old are being made new, and that all things are being brought to their perfection by him through whom all things were made, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Send your Spirit, God, to open our hearts and our minds to your word and strengthen us to live according to your will. In Jesus' name. Spoiler alert. The phrase for tonight is spoiler alert. There is nothing worse than having the plot twists of a story that you are following revealed by an overeager friend or broadcaster. Last Monday, as Kathy and I were driving, we heard an NPR announcer tell in detail the surprising developments in the seventh season opener of Mad Men that had been shown the night before. The problem is that Kathy and I are still in season four. The reporter did not seem to be hip to the fact that with the advent of web streaming and DVRs, people don't watch television the same way they did in the era of Ed Sullivan and The Fugitive. I couldn't reach the dial fast enough. Luckily, I'm so far back in the story that I didn't understand the shocking details, but still they're stuck in my head like the earworm of a really bad top 40 song. So, spoiler alert. I'm going to say a bit about a movie now that many of you may not have seen, a movie called All Is Lost. I saw it last week, and it has stayed with me for days. It is one of those films that you see and then you find yourself thinking about when you thought you were doing something else. But I promise you, I will not say anything that gives the ending away. All is Lost, of course, is the J.C. Chandor movie starring Robert Redford, and it depicts a man's struggle to survive alone in a boat at sea. It is a powerful, if hard to watch, film treating a number of issues: our ambitions, the illusions brought on by modern affluence, our trust in our things, human arrogance in regard to nature. But tonight, for us, All Is Lost is most powerfully about the tenuous relationship of life and death. Near the beginning of the film, we hear the main character say this in a voiceover. He says, "I'm sorry. I know that means little at this point, but I am. I tried. I think you would all agree that I tried. All is lost here except for soul and body. That is what's left of them and a half day's ration. I fought till the end. I'm not sure what this is worth, but I know that I did. I have always hoped for more for you all. I will miss you. I'm sorry." Spoiler alert, I cannot tell you how all this lost ends, because it ends ambiguously. The ending is a beautiful and fitting ending, but it is one that is open to multiple interpretations. According to audience surveys, one half of those seeing it think it ends happily. The other half think the reverse, kind of like American politics. For almost 2 hours, we have watched a man struggle against the elements, against human indifference, and against himself. At the end, we know that there is more to the story, but we don't know exactly what that more might be. We thought it was over, and now it's not. Spoiler alert, even when we think it's finished, there is something new before us. We think it is over, but now it is not. You could say as much about the two great feasts of freedom, Easter and Passover. In some sense, tonight's liturgy, the great vigil of Easter, is the church's way of observing Passover. Tonight we move with Israel from slavery into freedom. Tonight we move with Jesus from death to life. Easter is the Christian version of Passover. It is the day on which we proclaim that it isn't over when we think it is. It is the time we realize that even when all is lost, there is still something more. So let's think first about Passover. The Jewish holiday observes the Jews' journey from slavery to Egypt to freedom in the promised land of Canaan. Our Exodus reading tonight begins with them being pursued by Pharaoh's army on their way out of Egypt. The people complain, "Was it because there were no graves in Egypt that you have taken us away to die in the wilderness? What have you done to us, bringing us up out of Egypt?" All, it appears, is lost. But then there is more to the story. Moses stretches his hand over the sea, the waters part, and the Israelites pass through the Red Sea on the dry ground, through the sea, the waters forming a wall for them on their right and on their left. All appeared to be lost, and then it wasn't. From that day to this, Passover has been the central holiday for Jews around the world. It is the primal celebration of divine and human freedom. It's not only that people are set free, it's also that God is set free. Just when you thought that God couldn't do a new thing, there it was. At Passover, God demonstrates that something dramatically new and living can emerge from something we were sure was old and dead. Now, we Christians observe Passover at Easter because the earliest Christians were Jews. We tend to talk a lot about Passover on Maundy Thursday because we have that meal on Maundy Thursday. But the Easter vigil asks that we remember the Passover event of deliverance. In an astonishing expression of God's creative power, the enslaved Jews were set free from Pharaoh and Egypt. So when the earliest Christians tried to understand what the resurrection of Jesus meant to them, they turned naturally and first to Passover as an analog. The resurrection is our Passover. In another astonishing expression of God's creative power, the whole human family is now set free. The Jews were enslaved by Egypt, and you and I have been imprisoned by sin and death. But now, in Jesus, we're not. We think it is over, but then there is more. What that more might look like is, of course, open to interpretation. When we say that Jesus' resurrection liberates us from sin and death, we mean at least two things. We mean that we've been set free from sin and its power. Now, that doesn't make us immediately perfect or pure, but it does mean that who we are is finally good. We are set free from the power of sin, and so we are now able to live lives of hope and compassion and grace. The kind of life that Jesus lived is now open and available to all. We are not tied to our old, tired story. We can take on a new story. Dying to the old story and rising to the new is actually what really happens in baptism, which we celebrate tonight. When we renew our baptismal covenant together, we're stepping into a new and risen life in which our old habits and failures and betrayals no longer define us. We are stepping into our liberation from the power of sin. We are being taken up into God's astonishing creative power and letting it become the governing force of our lives. And that is how it is with the power of death as well. The resurrection of Jesus frees us from the power of death. It doesn't free us from death itself. Even Jesus, you know, had to die. But Jesus' new life empowers us to live lives freed from the tyranny and the fear of death. Now, to be honest, even after a lifetime of serving the church, I don't know precisely what that means. But I do know that just as God and Jesus stand with me in my woundedness, and just as they accompany me in my joyfulness, so they will accompany me as I pass from this life to what lies beyond. I don't think that that means that I'll be spending eternity watching Mad Men episodes with my wife and my son and my boyhood pets eating Hostess Twinkies in my heavenly barca lounger in the sky. But I do think it means that God's astonishing creative power is not done with me. God will use me. God will use us all. We will all be caught up into God's ongoing life as it works at the cosmic drama of love and redemption in the world. At Easter, we are set free from sin. At Easter, we are set free from death. First, it was one way, and now it's another. That's what dealing with Jesus and Jesus as God is like. God's most characteristic trait is the power to surprise. This Lent, I've been living with some words from Paul's second letter to the Corinthians. This text has always meant much to me, especially because it was Dietrich Bonhoeffer's favorite passage of Scripture, one that he returned to regularly during his captivity in a Nazi prison. It's a passage about God's radiance and about us, about things being first one way and then another. Here it is. Paul says, "Now the Lord is Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And all of us with unveiled faces, seeing the glory of the Lord as though reflected in a mirror, are being transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another. For this comes from the Lord, the Spirit." Spoiler alert, all is lost, and then it isn't. Before Easter, we saw God in ourselves one way. Our old story was caught up in sin and death. Now, after Easter, we will see it in another. Our new story is one of life and compassion and hope. Just when you thought it was over, it turns out there is more. Tonight, we make our Passover together from slavery to freedom, from sin and death to love and life. You and I, together, are being transformed from one degree of glory to another. It was one way, and now it is another. All was lost, and now there is more. Christ is risen. Happy Easter. Amen.
Candidate for holy baptism will now be presented.
I present Colleen Catherine Gardner to receive the sacrament of baptism. The bishop asks the following questions of the candidate.
Colleen, do you desire to be baptized?
I do.
Do you renounce Satan and all the spiritual forces of wickedness that rebel against God?
I renounce.
Do you renounce the evil powers of this world, which corrupt and destroy the creatures of God?
I renounce them.
Do you renounce all sinful desires that draw you from the love of God?
I renounce.
Do you turn to Jesus Christ and accept him as your Savior?
I do.
Do you put your whole trust in his grace and love?
I do.
Do you promise to follow and obey him as your Lord?
I do.
Thank you. Will the congregation please stand? Will you, who witness these vows, do all in your power to support this person in her life in Christ?
We will.
Through the Paschal mystery, dear friends, we are buried with Christ by baptism into his death and raised with him to newness of life. I call upon you, therefore, now that our Lenten observance is ended, to renew with this person about to be baptized the solemn promises and vows of holy baptism, by which we renounce Satan and all evil works, and promise to serve God faithfully in the Holy Catholic Church. Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God?
I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord.
He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary.
He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead.
Do you believe in God, the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Will you continue in the apostles' teaching and fellowship, in the breaking of bread and in the prayers?
I will, with God's help.
Will you persevere in resisting evil, and whenever you fall into sin, repent and return to the Lord?
I will, with God's help.
Will you proclaim by word and example the good news of God in Christ?
I will, with God's help.
Will you seek and serve Christ in all persons, loving your neighbor as yourself?
I will, with God's help.
Will you strive for justice and peace among all people and respect the dignity of every human being?
I will, with God's help.
Let
Let us now pray for Colleen Catherine Gartner, who is to receive the sacrament of new birth. Lord, hear our prayer. Deliver her, O Lord, from the way of sin and death. Lord, hear our prayer. Open her heart to your grace and truth. Lord, hear our prayer. Fill her with your holy and life-giving spirit. Lord, hear our prayer. Keep her in the faith and communion of your holy church. Lord, hear our prayer. Teach her to love others in the power of the Spirit. Lord, hear our prayer. Send her into the world in witness to your love. Lord, hear our prayer. Bring her to the fullness of your peace and glory. Lord, hear our prayer.
Grant, O Lord, that all who are baptized into the death of Jesus Christ, your Son, may live in the power of his resurrection and look for him to come again in glory, who lives and reigns now and forever. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
We thank you, Almighty God, for the gift of water. Over it, the Holy Spirit moved in the beginning of creation. Through it, you led the children of Israel out of their bondage in Egypt into the land of promise. In it, your son Jesus received the baptism of John and was anointed by the Holy Spirit as the Messiah, the Christ, to lead us through his death and resurrection from the bondage of sin into everlasting life. We thank you, gracious God, for the water of baptism. In it, we are buried with Christ in his death. By it, we share in his resurrection. Through it, we are reborn by the Holy Spirit. Therefore, in joyful obedience to Christ, we bring into this fellowship those who come to him in faith, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Now sanctify this water, we pray you, by the power of your Holy Spirit, that those who here are cleansed from sin and born again may continue forever in the risen life of Jesus Christ, our Savior. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. Colleen, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Colleen, you are sealed by the Holy Spirit in baptism and marked as Christ's own forever. Colleen, receive the light of Christ and carry this light into the world. Amen. Gracious God, we thank you that by water and the Holy Spirit, you have bestowed upon this, your servant, the forgiveness of sin, and have raised her to the new life of grace. Sustain her, O Lord, in your Holy Spirit. Give her an inquiring and discerning heart, the courage to will and to persevere, a spirit to know and to love you, and the gift of joy and wonder in all your works.
Amen.
Let us welcome the newly baptized. We receive you into the household of God. Confess the faith of Christ crucified, proclaim his resurrection, and share with us in his eternal priesthood.
The day. us to govern the night.
Thank you.
pray. O God, who made this most holy night to shine with the glory of the Lord's resurrection, stir up in your church that spirit of adoption which is given to us in baptism, that we, being renewed both in body and mind, may worship you in sincerity and truth. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
A reading from the letter of Paul to the Romans. Do you not know that of all who have been baptized into Christ Jesus, were baptized into his death? Therefore, we have been buried with him by baptism in death, so that, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, so we too might walk in the newness of life. For we have been united with him in death like his, we will certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. We know that our old self was crucified with him, so that the body of sin might be destroyed, and we might no longer be enslaved to sin. For whoever has died is freed from sin. But if we have died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. We know that Christ, we believe, will also live. We know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. The death he's died, he died to sin once and for all. But the life he lives to God. So you also must consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
After the Sabbath, as the first day of the week was dawning, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the tomb. And suddenly there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descending from heaven came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothing white as snow. For fear of him, the guards shook and became like dead men. But the angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid. I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he has been raised as he said. Come, see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, he has been raised from the dead, and indeed he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him. This is my message for you." So they left the tomb quickly with fear and great joy and ran to tell his disciples. Suddenly Jesus met them and said, "Greetings." And they came to him, took hold of his feet, and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee. There they will see me."
The Gospel of the Lord.
Of the Lord be always with you.
Good evening and welcome to the Cathedral. I'm Gary Hall, the Dean, and it's my pleasure on behalf of Bishop Budde and everyone who works and volunteers here regularly to welcome everyone tonight to Washington National Cathedral for this Easter Vigil, first celebration of Easter. Whoever you are, wherever you find yourself on the journey of faith, you are welcome at God's table to receive the bread and wine of communion. There are ushers who will direct you to the communion stations. If you would rather receive a blessing than take communion, please signal that to us by folding your arms across your chest, and we will know that that is your preference. As a person who's been wearing glasses since I was 10, I apologize to everyone wearing glasses who I hit in the face with water as I was walking down the aisle. But every once in a while, we have to take one for the team, and this is one of those nights. Easter is about freedom, it's about life, it's about love, it's about compassion, it's about joy. And part of what places like this do is we are power stations for the spreading of that life and love and compassion and joy in the world. And so tonight we invite you into relationship with us, not only inviting you to take communion, but to consider becoming more a part of our ongoing community of worship here in the Cathedral congregation. And we ask you tonight to help support us in this ministry of being a beacon of hope and life and joy of God's resurrected love and power in the world today. So we ask that you give generously to help to forward that mission and to celebrate God's risen, joyous, resurrected power in our lives and in the lives of the District of Columbia, our metropolitan area, the nation, and the world. Let us with gladness present the offerings and the oblations of our life and our labor to God.
Thank you.
be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. We praise you and we bless you, holy and gracious God, source of life abundant. From before time, you made ready the creation. Your spirit moved over the deep and brought all things into being, sun, moon, and stars, earth, winds, and waters, and every living thing. You made us in your image and taught us to walk in your ways, but we rebelled against you and wandered far away. And yet as a mother cares for her children, you would not forget us. Time and again, you called us to live in the fullness of your love. And so this night, we join with saints and angels in the chorus of praise that rings through eternity, lifting our voices to magnify you as we sing. Praise to you, holy and living God, to deliver us from the power of sin and death and to reveal the riches of your grace. You looked with favor upon Mary, your willing servant, that she might conceive and bear a son, Jesus, the Holy Child of God. Living among us, Jesus loved us. He broke bread with outcasts and sinners, healed the sick, and proclaimed good news to the poor. He yearned to draw all the world to himself, yet we were heedless of his call to walk in love. Then the time came for him to complete upon the cross the sacrifice of his life and to be glorified by you. On the night before he died for us, Jesus was at table with his friends. He took bread, gave thanks to you, broke it, and gave it to them and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." As supper was ending, Jesus took the cup of wine. Again, he gave thanks to you, gave it to them, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Now gathered at your table, O God of all creation, and remembering Christ, crucified and risen, who was and is to come, we offer to you our gifts of bread and wine and ourselves, a living sacrifice. Pour out your spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the body and blood of Christ. Breathe your spirit over the whole earth and make us your new creation, the body of Christ given for the world you have made. In the fullness of time, bring us with Mary, the mother of Jesus, Peter, Paul, and all your saints from every tribe and language and people and nation to feast at the banquet prepared from the foundation of the world. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, to you be honor, glory, and praise forever and ever. Amen. As we join our prayers with those of the Church Universal, so we say, each in our own language, the prayer that Jesus has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ lives for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Let us pray. God of abundance, you have fed us with the bread of life and the cup of salvation. You have united us with Christ and with one another. You have made us one with your people in heaven and on earth. Now send us forth in the power of your Spirit.
That we may proclaim your love to the world and continue to
May the peace, joy, and strength of the risen Christ be with you always. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you this night and forevermore. Amen.
Let us go forth into the world, rejoicing in the power of the Spirit.